repeat. So here we go. Session number four.
Yep.
So far, up to this point, we've talked a little bit about the fact that prayer is kind of like a toolbox. And we've pulled out the tools of adoration and petition. And today, we're going to be talking about one of my favorites, which is intercession.
Intercession, yeah.
Now, I think that word, though, can be a little scary for some people. So I'm wondering if maybe you can clear that up for us.
Sure. Well, it does sound a bit scary, but it's actually really, really simple. If petitionary prayer is asking God for our own needs, intercessory prayer is asking God for the needs of other people or other situations.
Is it really that simple?
It is as simple as that, honestly. If you want to get technical about it, one dictionary definition says that intercession means intervening or mediating between two parties as the equal friend of both. So, for example, in the Bible, do you remember where Esther goes to the king of Persia and intercedes on behalf of the people of Israel? She's pleading on their behalf. And one of the big promises in the Bible actually relates to intercession. You probably know it, 2 Chronicles 7, 13
yes.
and 14.
Classic.
It's that one where King Solomon has just finished building the temple. He spends a night in prayer, needs God to show up. God shows up and says this, "When I shut up the heavens so that there is no rain, or command locusts to devour the land, or I send a plague amongst my people. If my people, who are called by my name, will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sins and will heal their land." And I think it's significant. There's three little words in there that are so important. If, when, and then. So it's when things go wrong in life.
Because they will.
Right. Because we always sing, if things, you know, when things are going to go wrong. When things go wrong, if my people. Now, we tend to think that one is when, that, like, well, of course, God's people will pray. But we all know the reality is we all tend to try 101 other things before we just turn to God in prayer. So when things go wrong, if my people will pray, then God says, I'll hear from heaven, I will forgive our sins, that sort of sanctification, and I will heal our land. In other words, you could say that the hinge of human history is the bended knee. When God's people bend the knee, when they intercede, God intervenes. And it's a pattern that we see right the way through the Bible and actually right the way through church history. Before every major movement of the Holy Spirit, there's a movement of prayer.
What does healing the land actually mean?
That's a great question. King Solomon was king of an agrarian culture. So when he's talking about, you know, drought and locusts, he's not just talking about an environmental crisis, he's talking about an economic one. And so healing of the land is about transformation of society at every level. It's cultural, financial, political, ecological, and it's also about the forgiveness of sins. So it's about sanctification and holiness in the church at the same time.
Got it. I think living in Ibiza, I definitely see the need for that all around me.
Right.
And being an American as well, I think it feels like there's so much division over things like politics or race.
Right. And you may have noticed we've got one or two problems in the UK as well. The truth is, wherever you live in the world, there is an urgent need for the forgiveness of sins and the healing of the land. And that means that God's people must humble ourselves and seek God and pray for our world right now. And the great news is that this is a promise. It applies to all of us. It works. If we will intercede when things go wrong, then God will intervene and heal the land. I think about my friend Marcus Lagel, who grew up as a teenager in East Germany under communism. Do you remember when Germany was split in half, you know, the communist bit? And then he got caught up in the prayer meetings that started to take place in the city of Leipzig against communism and for the reunification of Germany, which meant that some of his formative teenage years, surprisingly, were spent wedged in amongst thousands of other people with candles burning, people crying out to God, snipers on the roof of buildings, like medical clinics set up in church buildings in case people got shot. And on the night that the Berlin Wall came down, they estimate there were up to 300,000 1,000 people praying for a peaceful end to communism in Leipzig. One communist official in an unguarded moment the next day said to a journalist, "We were prepared for every eventuality, but not for prayers and not for candles."
Wow.
So this stuff really does make a difference.
I think, you know, hearing those stories is just so, so encouraging, right? But it's also a little daunting. I mean, you've got Esther in the Bible, you've got your friend Marcus, both of them interceding and really changing the fate of nations.
Yeah.
And it leaves me wondering, like, is this stuff for normal people? Or is this kind of prayer just for spiritual heavyweights?
Now, I feel really strongly that intercession is for everyone for a number of reasons. Firstly, because we are filled with the Spirit of God. And the Bible says that the Spirit of God is interceding for you and me in groans that words can't express. The Bible says that Jesus lives to intercede. And so to be filled with God is to be filled with intercession. And also, I just think intercession means that you care. Like if you care about people and situations, you instinctively lift them to God in prayer.
But why does God need us to do that? I mean, you've just said that Jesus is interceding for us at the right hand of the Father, right? The Holy Spirit is interceding for us as well. So it kind of feels like God's already got it all covered. Uh-huh. Why does he need us to join in?
It's an incredible biblical reality that God has designed the world to work in such a way that our human wills work in partnership with God's will. In other words, things aren't just automatic and predetermined in life. Our choices really, really do make a difference. And we kind of know that, don't we, in practice. You could walk out of here now and do something terrible, and God's not going to stop it. Or you could do something wonderful. And in just the same way, in prayer, our free wills really make a difference. The great French philosopher Blaise Pascal said, "God has instituted prayer to bestow upon his creatures the dignity of causality." Mm. I love that. The dignity of being able to cause, shape, co-create reality with God. God is the great delegator. We assume he's a tyrant, like just anything God wants to happen happens, but he actually delegates his power to our free wills in almost like a scary way at times. There's a story during the Crimean War of the 19th century. There was a Scotsman called James Matheson who would often intercede all night for the members of the 93rd Highlanders who were fighting on the front lines, many of them dying. And on a number of occasions, there in the trenches, the soldiers reported seeing somebody that none of them recognized. And there was always a kind of a great sense of peace around this person they saw whenever he appeared. Fast forward a little bit, it's after the war, the 93rd Highlanders have returned to Scotland and they're attending a communion service at the church in Crieff one day. James Matheson, this guy who's been interceding for them, walks into the church. They look at him and gasp because he is the person that they had seen in the trenches night after night. And I don't know. I mean, I know stuff like that sounds kind of freaky and weird, but it's actually a very biblical kind of a thing to happen. If you think about that story in Exodus 17, where the people of Israel have been attacked and they're trying to defend themselves in the valley. Joshua is the great military leader there, leading the army. And Moses climbs a mountain overlooking the battle. And he lifts his hands in prayer because that's the way that they used to intercede. And his friends Aaron and Hur hold his hands aloft because they discover that as long as Moses is praying, the Israelites led by Joshua are winning. Mm. And whenever he takes his hands down, which is like whenever he stops interceding, they start to lose ground. Mm. So it's a powerful picture of that link between what happens on the ground day to day in Ibiza, you know, in wherever in our lives, and how as we lift our hands as it were in prayer, we change things on earth. Mm. Our free wills really are powerful. They can release or restrict the very purposes of God. That our free wills actually are free. You know, we can make choices. We're not just like automatons, like bound to do whatever God wants. And I think in intercession, we bring our free wills to God and we say, here's a landing pad for your will. Let your will be done. Let your kingdom come in this person or in this situation.
Mm. It's like you're saying that I can shape the future like through my prayers, basically.
Yeah.
And that if I don't pray, then stuff won't happen. Is that what you're saying?
It's actually not just what I'm saying. It really is what God says in the Bible. Mm. There's that story, you may remember it, in Genesis chapter 18. Abraham is kind of negotiating with God because God has seen the unbelievable oppression that's going on in Sodom, the city of Sodom. And he says, I'm going to destroy it. This isn't because God's like nasty. It's because he's seeing people being hurt and abused and just he's heard the cries.
Seeing the injustice.
Right. Yeah. And he's like, I just got to blow the final whistle on this place. But Abraham, his nephew Lot is living in that city. Mm. Often we intercede, we care because we know people
yes.
in places, right?
Yeah.
And so he begins to cry out to God, please don't destroy this city. And it's like he haggles God down. It's the most amazing story. And eventually he says to God, if just 10 righteous people left in the city, please spare it. And God says, okay. Mm. So we do see that our free wills really are free. We actually can make choices in prayer and somehow partner with God. He says to Adam and Eve, look, you can do anything you want, but just don't eat the fruit of that tree. And then they say, not your will, but my will, and eat the fruit. And in that moment that we call the fall, every sin and sickness, every cancer comes into creation, and we live with the devastating consequences of it to this day. So when we use our free wills to do the exact reverse of that curse, when Adam and Eve said, not your will, but my will, when we say, not my will, but God's will, that releases blessing. It breaks that whole vicious cycle. And so instead of sin and sickness and suffering coming into our world, through our choices, we see healing and hope and love come into the world. It's kind of as powerful as that. Prayer isn't about trying to get God to say amen to what I want. Prayer is about me saying amen to God's will for my life, with my words, with my vocabulary, with my relationships, with everything about me. How do I work out what God wants and then say amen to it with the way I live?
Mm. So I get that this is biblical, but I think it also still does feel a little lofty. Is there a way you can give us maybe an example from your own life of a time that you interceded for something and saw God do something?
Yeah, I think this happens all the time for Christians. God answers prayer for other people, other places. Just like we're running Alpha right now in our church. And a couple of nights ago, we had loads of guests and we have our prayer room under where Alpha takes place. And we always have a bunch of people interceding as the course is going on. And it's amazing how often they discern stuff and pray into stuff that then later the group leaders go, yeah, that's exactly what was going on. We definitely see a connection. We wouldn't want to do Alpha if we didn't have the prayer thing going on. Or a couple of weeks ago, I was talking to a member of our church called Jonathan, who's not like some big prayer warrior guy. He works in London, in the city. He was just telling me he'd gone in very early to work for a meeting near Parliament back in August, on August 14th. And as he walked the streets, he was remembering how we had a terror attack in that part of London last year. It was terrible, 50 people were injured, 5 were killed. And as he thought about it, he just became really, really troubled and began to pray for protection and safety on all the people like walking the streets and the offices around and Parliament and so on. And it was so strong that he actually ended up walking those streets for an hour.
Wow.
Praying and thinking, is this crazy? Like, what's going on? Why do I feel so troubled? It's not something he'd normally do. By 7:30 a.m., he ran out of stuff to pray about, checked into a coffee shop, sat down to drink coffee. 7 minutes later, a terrorist drove into pedestrians just 100 yards from where Jonathan was sitting. And obviously, we'll never know whether, you know, his intercession had that direct sort of impact. But what we do know is that in the previous attack last year, There were 50 injured and 5 killed. This time there were only 3 people left with very minor injuries, no one killed, and there just happened to be an ambulance driving right behind the terrorists' car. So people got attention instantly. And what's more than that, CCTV footage revealed that the terrorist had been driving those very streets for the hour before the attack and had almost certainly driven past Jonathan, who was interceding against that attack.
Wow.
And then it gets more amazing because then Jonathan's wife, Linda, said to me that morning, she was woken early at home. She said, I never wake up early, but I woke up early with this sense, I need to pray for Jonathan's protection on his way to work. And so you can think that's coincidence if you want, but I think that's how God often uses us to intercede to make a difference.
I think there's a story, right, about you guys praying for rain in Ibiza?
Yeah, close to home for you, obviously. Yeah, that was in the early days, and that's a good example of intercession. It was actually really scary. The kind of chaplain of one of the churches on the island said to us, can you guys please pray for rain? Because Ibiza, Mediterranean island, but it was in major drought. It was the summertime. And I remember thinking, oh no, that's a really big prayer.
That's a huge prayer.
Right. And people can go, either it did rain or it didn't. It's measurable.
Right.
But we had to do it because he'd asked us. So we all like raised our hands. We cried out to God for it to rain. Not a lot of faith, if I'm honest. And I still remember getting into the car to drive back down the mountain to where we were staying. And the first splats of rain hitting the windscreen. And, you know, you put your windscreen wipers on and it's like mud on the thing at first. And just then my phone went and it was a text message from one of our mission teams in St. Petersburg, Russia. Someone was sitting in a prayer room there and they had a scripture, I think it's from 1 Kings, saying, God says, I will send the rain. Mm. So, I mean, the timing was incredible. By the time we got back to where we were staying, there were floods.
Wow.
And I remember some of the team climbed onto the flat roof of the house and did this weird rain dance thing. And then I'm just thinking, because I'm always wanting to find a rational answer. I'm like, maybe that was just fluke. But we checked the records and we found out it hadn't rained that heavily in Ibiza in that month since 1976.
Wow.
So if it's coincidence, it is a pretty remarkable one. And actually the British media later called it a miracle. Hudson Taylor, who's the great apostle to China, he said this, we must learn to move man through God by prayer alone. And that's the power of intercession.
Mm. So what do we do if we feel like you're just not at that level yet,
right?
So you're not at the level where your prayers are changing the weather or stopping terrorist attacks. You're just praying for your neighbor's cat that's stuck up a tree or something like that. Like, how do you get from that level to the kind of intercession that you're talking about?
Okay, 4 practical steps. The first one is this, get informed, engage with the facts, whether it's the needs of your neighbor, the name of the cat up the tree, or the problems that are going on in another country. Phone a friend, say, how can I pray for you today? Get to know people at work so that you can actually pray for them beyond just the office gossip. Sign up for news updates from NGOs that you want to support. So just the facts, your friends, get the data, get informed. Secondly, get inspired. Engage God's word. What's God saying about this person or this place, this situation? Maybe there's a promise in scripture that you can claim. So you're not just praying randomly for some person at work, but God, what are you saying here?
Mm.
So that's the second thing, get inspired. The third one is get indignant, okay?
Love that word.
Yeah, just get fired up, engage your own heart. Allow the things that break God's heart to break your heart too. Feel this stuff. I guess it's kind of outrageous when God wants something to happen in a particular personal place and it's being resisted, it's not happening. That is outrageous, isn't it? Because God's will should be done. And so intercessory prayer can often be quite forceful, quite passionate. Finally, having got informed, got inspired, got indignant, get in sync. Get in sync with other Christians. Engage the saints, because it's more powerful to intercede with other people. Jesus says that if 2 of you on earth agree about anything they ask for, it'll be done for you by my Father in heaven. And that's why this word amen is actually such a powerful thing to say. It's not just like a formal religious way of signing off at the end of a prayer time. It literally means I agree with what's been said. Let it happen.
I love that. It's so helpful. So we're going to get informed,
right.
Get inspired, yep. My favorite, get indignant,
yes.
And get in sync.
Get in sync.
Why don't we pray?
Let's do that.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, God. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. God, we just pray right now for people who are just in pain, God, and we pray that you would break into their situations, God. Lord, break our hearts for the things that break yours. Jesus, teach us to pray. Amen.
Amen.